Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to your course, Compulsory English 2. I'm Dr. Muhammad Kamal Khan, your course coordinator, and with me is my guest speaker, Professor Soumya Sohail.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Soumya Sohail. I'm an assistant professor of English and have been teaching for almost 19 years now.
This course is based on improving your communication skills in English and the approaches that we want to enable you to become a very positive, very constructive, and very effectively using communication skills in English. Dear students, as you know that there are four basic language skills, listening, speaking, reading, and writing. And we are focusing particularly in this course on two skills, which are written language skills. Basically, the two skills are, reading and writing. So our focus in this course is going to be on these two skills, academic reading and academic writing. This course is basically comprised of 9 units. The first 5 units are related to academic writing, and the last 4 units are based on academic reading. In academic writing, we are going to focus upon the organization of text. We'll be particularly discussing various techniques related to the organization of text, like cause and effect, sequence, and also classification, and techniques like compare and contrast. In the last 4 units, we'll be focusing on various sub-skills of reading. We'll be discussing particularly those techniques and those skills which are required for effective reading. We'll be highlighting some techniques like skimming and scanning, and also like we'll be discussing upon various kinds of meanings like denotative meanings and connotative meanings. And the objectives of this course are basically to realize and to let you know the importance of academic reading and writing. While doing so, we'll be teaching you some particular characteristics and features of academic reading and writing. And then we'll also introduce you to various kinds of writing, like expository writing, narrative writing, descriptive writing, and we'll also be discussing about how to evaluate and respond a particular piece of academic writing, right? And how to infer meaning from academic writing, and how to jump to the conclusion, and then to know the objectives of a writer and to comment on those points which are written by an academic writer. So the point is that we'll be highlighting various techniques to identify points which are related to academic writing, and to enable you to make inferences and to make conclusion about a particular text. So these are the objectives of this course, which is Compulsory English 2. Now let me just invite my guest speaker to start with the definition of academic writing. So Ma'am Soumya, please, could you define academic writing?
Yes. To me, any written assignment that is done for academic purposes is academic writing. It okay. involves academic writing. Mm-hmm. It can start from college or university assignments. It can be the writings that teachers and researchers do for purposes like writing books, for carrying out research projects, and for writing down those research projects in the forms of dissertations and theses. It can be the survey reports that are made. It can be the essays that students write in schools, colleges, or universities.
Right. Thank you very much, Ma'am Soumya. So, guys, academic writing is basically a particular kind of writing which is based on very specific expressions and very specific technical language, and also a very stylistic kind of, like you are focusing on a very constant style in academic writing. And in a very brief definition, academic writing is like formal, and it's to some extent very complex as well. And it's objective. We are not putting anything from our own emotions and minds. And then it's something which is explicitly written. And since academic writing is supposed to be very, very responsible, so academic writing is also a kind of responsible writing. Ma'am, do you know that we are not supposed to add up anything to and everything to academic writing?
Yes, this is true.
Yeah.
And I believe that in order to understand academic writing, we first need to know the process of writing itself.
Yeah.
Writing is a process in which you are doing certain things and you are going back and forth and repeating those things and those practices. If you look at the screen, you can see that you can visualize the writing process. Writing process involves planning and shaping. It involves drafting, revising, editing, and proofreading. Now, all these, we can see how all these processes or how all these stages in the writing process work. Planning means discovering and compiling ideas for your writing. Shaping means organizing your material. Drafting means writing your material into sentences and paragraphs. Revising means evaluating your draft and then rewriting it by adding, deleting, rewording, and rearranging. Editing means checking for correct grammar, spelling, punctuation, and mechanics. Proofreading means reading your final copy to eliminate typing or handwriting errors. So this is the process that the writers follow when they are writing for a project. It may be, again, for the students who are writing or for the teachers or researchers who are writing for specific purposes.
Ma'am Soumya, thank you very much. Dear students, these are very important tips which are given by Ma'am Soumya. And you must know that we are not putting up everything in academic writing. When you are supposed to write down a piece of academic writing, you must be very, very careful. And you are required to avoid certain things which may be, you know, used in some other kinds of writing, but in particularly in academic writing, you are supposed to avoid, number one, colloquial language, right? Because in academic writing, we are not putting any kind of colloquial or conversational kind of language, right? Then this point is related to particularly to your language. Because such expressions which are colloquial are not really used in academic writing. Like you are not using words like yeah, right? Or like cute, right? So these are the, you know, the types of expressions which are to be avoided in academic writing. And then we are also supposed to be avoiding jargons, the very specific, very technical vocabulary, which is used in a very technical, you know, type of context. So the technical jargon is not used in academic writing. We are also supposed to be avoiding slangs in academic writing because slang is a kind of language which is very impolite, and expressions which are impolite are not supposed to be the part of academic writing. And the last point is that we are not supposed to be using any kind of cliche in our academic writing. And you know, like the expressions such as clean and fresh, last but not least. So these are the phrases which are considered cliches and which are avoided in academic writing. So remember that you are supposed to be avoiding certain features in academic writing. Dear students, we are required to know various features of academic writing. And you know, we'll be focusing on various parts of writing as well. Like we may be starting with the parts of paragraph, we may be focusing on various kinds of essays, and therefore various kinds of academic writings, okay? We have types of essays which are considered academic essays, like we have descriptive essays while describing a particular phenomena or a design or an object, so descriptive essays. And then we also have narrative essays. Narrative essays are most of the time about like telling stories and also like narrating an event or sharing an experience, right? So that is called narrative essays. And then we also have argumentative essays. So argumentative essays are actually those essays in which the writer is particularly focusing on persuading about a particular point, or like just to convince his or her readers on a particular point. So those essays are called argumentative essays. And we also have one more kind of essays, which is called expository essays. So expository essays are essays when we are dealing with particular, you know, facts and figures. So these are the kinds of essays. Now we'll request our guest speaker to ma'am, please tell us about the structure of academic writing.
Thank you. Actually, the structure of academic writing is something that should be kept in mind while we are doing all kinds of academic writing. Whatever kind of essay you are writing, whatever type of report you may be writing, there are certain features that are related to the structure of academic writing, and that they are to be kept in mind while writing for academic purposes. The structure of academic writing normally has three parts. The first part is introduction. The second part constitutes the body paragraphs, and it ends with conclusion. As far as introduction is concerned, in introduction, we set the stage. The writer sets the stage for what is to come. He tries to capture the reader's attention and interest in the topic. And normally, in most of academic writing, thesis statement is a part of introductory paragraph. Now, there must be some introductory device that leads to thesis statement. It should not be given in a haphazard or abrupt manner. So for introductory paragraph, we have certain things strategies that we need to keep in mind, and there are other strategies that we need to avoid. Strategies that you need to use include providing relevant background information, relating briefly an interesting story or anecdote, giving one or more pertinent, perhaps surprising statistics, asking one or more provocative questions, using an appropriate quotation, defining a key term, presenting one or more brief examples, and drawing an analogy. There are certain things that you need to avoid while writing the introduction to an academic writing project. Strategies that you need to avoid include: don't write statements about your purpose, such as, "I am going to discuss the causes of falling oil prices." Don't apologize, as in, "I'm not sure this is right, but this is my opinion." Don't use overworked expressions such as, "Haste makes waste, as I recently discovered," or, "Love is grand." So while you are writing introduction, these are the things that you need to keep in mind, and there are other things that you need to avoid. After writing an introduction, the organization requires you to write body paragraphs. When you write body paragraphs, they can be two, they can be more than two, but they contain the main thesis of the essay or any academic writing project. In the body paragraphs, you give the main idea, and that main idea is supported by evidence from the world that you live in. And it may be divided into different paragraphs. For example, if you are giving reasons, you may give a separate paragraph to all the reasons. If you are giving effect of something or some phenomenon, you can again give one paragraph each to each effect that it has caused. We have some procedure of how to create body paragraphs. So what are the things that we need to keep in mind while we are writing body paragraphs? If you look at the screen, you will have three characteristics of effective body paragraphs. These are called UDC. By U, we mean unity. Have you made a clear connection between the main idea of the paragraph and the sentences that support the main idea? Then comes development. Have you included detailed and sufficient support for the main idea of the paragraph? And then comes coherence. Have you progressed from one sentence to the next in the paragraph smoothly and logically? Coherence plays a very important role in writing body paragraphs, because you will have to see that the paragraphs are logically connected with each other. This comes in the organization of the paragraph or the academic writing project that you're doing. The organization requires that all that you have written must be connected in one way or the other. Things that you are saying within a paragraph or in many paragraphs should have some connection, and they must come out logically. The reader, when he reads that academic writing project, should not have an idea that all the paragraphs or the sentences in the paragraph are put together without having a connection among themselves. Then comes the supporting detail. For supporting detail, on the screen you can see that there is a test for checking that you have written the supporting details in the right manner. There is R for reasons. Reasons provide support. E for examples that too provide support. N for names that provide support. Sometimes numbers provide support. And there are times where senses, sight, sound, smell, taste, and touch provide support. Similarly, when we talk about coherence, there are things that are needed to be kept in mind while you're arranging and organizing a paragraph. And this goes on to include arranging many paragraphs into an essay. On the screen, you see that the ways to arrange sentences in a paragraph are, you can arrange sentences by time, by location, from general to specific, from specific to general, from least to most important, from problem to solution. These are some of the ideas, or these are some of the help that can be extended to a writer, the one who has a project of writing and writing an essay or any academic writing project. Now, when we come to the conclusion, this is to be kept in mind that conclusion should not be a rewriting of all that has gone before, and not even a rewriting of the introductory passage. Conclusion rather should sum up, in short, all that you have said in an essay or any academic writing project. What you do in conclusion is that there are certain things that you try to do in a conclusion, and again, there are certain things that you need to avoid while concluding your essay. The strategies that you can try in conclusion are a strategy adapted from those used for introductory paragraphs, but be careful to choose a different strategy for your introduction and conclusion. Relating a brief concluding interesting story or anecdote, giving one or more pertinent, perhaps surprising concluding statistics, asking one or more provocative questions for further thought, using an appropriate quotation to sum up the thesis statement, redefining a key statement for emphasis. Similarly, there are an analogy that summarizes the thesis statement, a summary of the main points, but only if the piece of writing is longer than 3 to 4 pages, a statement that urges awareness by the readers, a statement that looks ahead to the future, or a call to readers. There are certain strategies that you need to avoid while designing a conclusion to your academic writing project. Strategies to avoid are introducing new ideas or facts that belong in the body of the essay, rewording your introduction, announcing what you have discussed, as in this paper I've explained why oil prices have dropped, making absolute claims, as in I have proved that oil prices don't always affect gasoline prices, or apologizing, as in even though I am not an expert, I feel my position is correct. So these are the things that you need to avoid while writing down and designing your conclusion.
Well, thank you very much, ma'am. Guys, it was, you know, introduction to the parts of academic writing, and it's about the very general structure of an academic text. We are starting with introduction, then we have the proper body, and then we have at the end the conclusion of the academic writing piece of writing. And remember, as ma'am has very clearly explained, that we need to go for the introduction of what we are going to do in that piece of academic writing. We are actually very explicitly and very specifically introducing the topic. It's like just creating the ground for what you are going to say. And the very next is the part which is called the body of the academic text. In the body, focus on the connections which are required among sentences and then also among paragraphs. And we are required to go with a very coherent and very cohesive style of writing. And in body, we are required to provide particular evidences and proofs whatever point we are going to analyze and write about. And I remember that the end, which is conclusion, is again to be very explicit and very specific. And in the conclusion, we are summing up whatever we have already said. So three parts: introduction, body, and conclusion. But remember that while doing all these three parts, you must be focusing on your very strong composition skills, right? Your composition should be excellently written, and then you must have excellent grammar, right? So these are, you know, the value addition to your structure of any piece of academic writing. And you must be following consistent, you know, style, okay? Because in academic writing, we are required to follow a certain mechanics and also certain, you know, linguistic features. So the style must be consistent. So these are the features of, you know, an academic text. Dermam, while you were just talking about this paragraph writing, like you in the body of an academic text, you mentioned that we are required to go for various paragraphs. So could you please tell us about how to build upon a paragraph, how to start a paragraph, and how to, you know, provide evidences?
Okay. Actually, writing a paragraph is itself a part of academic writing. And there is a structure that a paragraph follows. You must have heard about topic sentence. Now, topic sentence is that sentence of the paragraph that carries the load of the paragraph itself, that carries the meaning of the paragraph, and the rest of the paragraph supports or explains or describes or analyzes the detail related to the topic sentence. Now, there is a misconception in an academia that the topic sentence should always be the first sentence of the paragraph. Mm. I want you to know that the topic sentence may come in the beginning. It may be the first sentence of the paragraph, taking all the load of the paragraph, telling in clear terms, stating very explicitly what the paragraph is all about. But then there are cases, and there can be times, where you are using or writing the topic sentence at the end of that paragraph. Some writers try to describe or give examples or analyze an issue in the paragraph, and then at the end they sum all that up in the form of the topic sentence. So in that case, a topic sentence may come at the end of the paragraph. And very interestingly, dear students, you might have noticed in the writing, in the readings that you've done and the writings of many writers, that topic sentence sometimes may not be very explicitly stated in a paragraph. It may be implied. It may not be given that clearly. Maybe the whole paragraph implies the topic sentence, and no single sentence bears the load of the whole paragraph. To understand the paragraph, you need to read all of it and then try to create a general understanding of that paragraph. There is no single sentence in that paragraph that can be spotted as the topic sentence. So in your writing, in your academic writing projects, you can have all these three ways of writing a topic sentence. It can come in the beginning, it can be the sentence that the paragraph starts with, or it can be the sentence that the paragraph ends with. And sometimes there may not be a single sentence that may be said to be the topic sentence of that paragraph. Rather, the whole paragraph carries or that implicit meaning what the topic sentence should be. So the topic sentence is then supported by supporting detail that we have already talked about in the previous few minutes, and we have already said what kind of supporting detail, like names, numbers, examples, and so much more, that can go on to explain the topic sentence.
All right. Thank you very much, Professor Soumya. So guys, this was all about your Unit 1, which is Introduction to Academic Writing. We started with the introduction to the course, and we also just very briefly discussed the objectives of the course. You know, the main goal is to enable you to come up with you know, a very technically written you know, piece of writing which is very coherent, very cohesive, and you are using explicitly those devices which we have discussed, and that's the ultimate goal of this course. And we also discussed that academic writing is a kind of writing which is based on a particular style of expression, and also it is based on a strong composition skills, and you are required to go with a very consistent style. And we also discussed the general structure of an academic piece of writing, the introduction, the body, and the conclusion. And at the end we discussed, and I'm very happy to know that there are particular techniques which you can use in order to create your very a novel kind of a topic sentence, as discussed by ma'am. Like, you may not be really explicitly telling us about your topic statement. You may be telling this in the beginning or also at the end. So that's a very unique point which we must think about. And then the support sentences, which are to prove and to support your stance, which you may be taking in your thesis statement or like into a topic sentence. So this is all about your unit 1, and see you in your unit 2.